I had these visions that I wanted to be something bigger. I wanted to do better. So this opportunity came up to buy this building, and you know, it just made sense. You know, the price had dropped a little bit. So I bought this building, and now I'm really stretching myself.
Yeah.
And so I'd stretched myself quite a bit between the home and the new building. I'd stretched myself. And then, you know, we had started seeing the practice kind of stagnate.
We've been misled to believe that dentistry, more specifically the dental business, has to be complicated. Dentistry can be simple, and dentistry should be simple.
Welcome back to another episode of the Dentistry Made Simple podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Tarun Agrawal, better known as T-Bone, and we're finally rejoined by my wonderful co-host, Meredith Cooper-Jones.
Okay, so that's not true because you weren't here last week. Or a few weeks ago.
But I did a few episodes without you, just so you know.
So I'm back. But I'm like on like every other one, so they're going to get confused.
We'll see. We'll see. I just like making fun of you, Mary Bear.
I know. All right. Well, I have
hold
a few
on.
Things.
Hold on. I want to tell them what I want to talk about.
Okay.
So this week, we're going to talk about making your practice recession resistant in 2022. Not recession proof, because it's, look, we live in a world where it's almost impossible to be recession proof, but we want to make it recession resistant, so that way we don't really kind of get too big of a hit if we actually run into a recession.
All right, well, before we get into today's episode about recession resistant practices, let's talk a little bit about what some wins are some of our doctors have had through Mastermind and some of our other programs. This one says, when to share. I heard the most beautiful four words a dentist could hear this morning. What do you think it is? When can we start? I think this was the first time that I've had this response to asking my patient if they had any questions for me. Had two planning visits this morning, closed a $9,000 case and a $19,000 case. Both are scheduled. The power of photography, financial arrangements, and the schedule/infrastructure to support it. I can't believe how well it's working. It's blowing my mind. Can't wait to get my team to boot camp.
Yeah, and that's really the beauty of Mastermind is we're really kind of getting people to rethink what their practice can be, helping them think about what they want their practice to be, and then giving them the tools that's been proven to work in my practice for 22 years, proven to work in Sully's practice for 7 years, and really giving them the tools. And the most important part is the ongoing coaching and accountability to really kind of get things going. And what we see consistently is at about the 6 month mark is really when people start having the things click. And then, you know, for this particular person, they joined the Advanced Mastermind and continued on with us. So we're super excited to get Ryan moving forward even farther.
Yeah, and one thing I hear a doctor actually told me last weekend was he didn't have the time to do Mastermind. Mm-hmm. He was just really busy.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's when you need it the most.
Most, yeah.
It's so hard. You know, I want to tell them that. And it's like hard to tell someone you don't really know that. So he's also excited about bringing his team to boot camp. Yeah. I just wanted to mention our next Team 3D Business and Case Acceptance Boot Camp will be January 26th and 27th. This is a great time to get your team on board with photography, transfers, communication, and
financial arrangements, scheduling. Yeah. It's really kind of the principles of our Mastermind driven down into 2 days, really focused on training the team.
Yeah. And creates good culture because we all have a good time.
Yeah, we do.
Well, let's get into today's episode on building resistance for a recession.
All right.
So I know a lot of our listeners probably haven't been through a recession.
That's because they're young.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to say without saying it. Let me rephrase this. We weren't working when the recession came the last time. And I think a lot of people, COVID kind of scared them in the beginning. It ended up actually being okay or better for most practices, but they haven't been through something like 08.
Yeah.
So since you were working then and you did go through that, will you talk to us a little bit about how that was?
Yeah, so you know, when it comes to dentistry, I've been through a couple of recessions. One was a short-term recession, which was 2001 after 9/11. You know, things dipped, airline dipped, people were scared, our country went into war, and certainly it kind of affected things.
Yeah. Okay. Do you think that was like how COVID was going to be had?
You know, I kind of had prepped myself for like that, you know, yeah. but the problem with that is, and this kind of leads into 2008, I thought 2001 was bad until 2008 right. came.
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh my God.
That was nothing.
But see, I didn't go into 2008 thinking it was going to be what it was or understanding right. how bad things could be. I just said, oh, if it's like 2001,
we'll be fine.
We'll be fine. Right. It'll be 6 months, 9 months.
I think everyone's
we'll kind of figure through that. And then so when COVID started, I kind of thought it was going to be like that, 2008. So, you know, what I'd like to do is kind of frame for people what 2008 was for me. One is you started hearing in late 2007, early 2008, that there's this rumbling of the economy faltering, home sales faltering, you know, the news doesn't really sell it truthfully, yeah. right? And so you're like, oh, it's no big deal. Things are great. But you're hearing these rumbles of things in yeah. the background, almost like we're doing right now. And so what had happened is in 2003, I had bought a house. And by 2007, I was starting to make really good money. And mm-hmm. and we had, at that point, we got a kid and we had another one on the way. And I was like, you know, it's time for us to upgrade homes. And in the summer of 2007, I bought a brand new, you know, very... very expensive home. Expensive to me. I mean, it was expensive
yeah.
home.
Yeah.
And so I had that. And so that kind of had stretched, you know, my budget and stuff. And then and my wife and Mona wasn't working at the time. So that had stretched my budget. And then, you know, about a few months after that, you know, about 6 months or so later, an opportunity came up to buy this building that I wasn't planning on moving out of my existing building, which was paid off, which was 4 operatories and all these things. But I had these visions that I wanted to be something bigger. I wanted to do better. So this opportunity came up to buy this building, and you know, it just made sense. You know, the price had dropped a little bit. So I bought this building, and now I'm really stretching myself.
Yeah.
And so I'd stretched myself quite a bit between the home and the new building. I had stretched myself. And then, you know, we had started seeing the practice kind of stagnate about mid-2008 or so. And I bought this building in June 2008. And then it was like the bottom dropped out and business dropped like 30%. And when business drops 30%, suddenly there's no margin. And as the owner-operator dentist, there's hardly any, if any, money to pay me. And then on top of that, I had the increased bills of my new home and the increased bills of this new building.
Right.
So it kind of, you know, and then the other part of it was, you know, I was living on big cases. You know, at that point we were doing 4 to 6, 10 unit cosmetic cases per month. I didn't really have much general dentistry in the practice, just some,
yeah.
but I was living off marketing and big cases. And so, you know,
the first thing people don't do.
Yeah.
When they get, even before they lose their job or anything mm-hmm. like that, if they get scared,
they stop spending money. They hunker down.
Right. Especially on larger things that are not necessary.
The elective, right?
Right.
And so it all came to a head probably about early 2009. At that point, I had been making it by, and, you know, the only saving grace I had was that, when I bought a Cadillac Escalade in 2007 when Yush was born, and I had signed up for a 3-year note instead of a 5 or 6 year note. And then I had to go sell the car because it had some equity in it to actually make payroll in 2009. And, you know, that's when things started to have to change for me. You know, I never wanted to do that again. I never wanted to feel that again. And so that's kind of the framework that I live in. And the reason I bring that up is I don't want you guys to think I'm trying to scare you, but experience dictates kind of how you react to things. And so that experience is worst case scenario. And so anytime we hear things and I hear recession, you know, because of my experience, I automatically think 2008, not 2001. And so my brain and my body and my reaction is, oh my God, this is what's coming up. How do I adjust and what do I have to do to kind of get prepared and survive and thrive after the recession?
Yeah. So when you came to this realization mm-hmm. that you were going to have to do something different, what was it that made you think, and what was it that you did to do that?
Well, looking back, you know, there are several things I did at the time that I don't quite remember because honestly, a lot of it was I was just throwing things at the wall to see what would stick. I literally was, we were buy one, get one crown free. I mean, it was.
It doesn't matter if you only need one.
No. I mean, you know.
We cosmetics. Didn't
no, yeah. Well, cosmetics had dried up.
Right.
And part of that was. One thing I did learn that I wouldn't do differently now is I stopped my marketing. But part of that was because I had spent so much on my home and spent so much on this building that I just didn't have the money to put into the marketing. And I was unwilling to borrow money to get through. And frankly, maybe the bank wouldn't have let me borrow it. I don't know. Yeah. But I cut my marketing off, which only made it worse. So one thing I would say differently now is don't cut your marketing off, but don't continue to spend wastefully. Be more, you know, conscious and conscientious about the marketing that you do. But looking back, I think the biggest challenge to me in 2008 was that my practice was built on big cases. And for those of you that have seen me speak or that have been to our programs here at 3D Dentist or have seen me lecture, you'll see that I often, most of the time, start most of my programs with the three parts of a good long-term practice, which is one, the biggest circle is general dentistry, then there's advanced dentistry, then there's emotional and elective dentistry. And I had built this practice because of the cosmetic dentistry boom from Extreme Makeover, the Swan, and all these different things. I had built my practice to be limited or basically live off of elective dentistry. And as you mentioned, it was one of the first things that that people cut off during this time.
Yeah.
So I made a concerted effort that I needed to rebuild my general or rebuild a general dentistry base because that was the least out of pocket for patients. That was my thinking. Because, you know, patients that kept their jobs, okay,
still
had insurance, they had insurance, cleanings were essentially free to them, you know, restorations were minimal cost and things like that. Whereas asking somebody to spend $10,000-$12,000 out of pocket was a big ask at that time, especially with all the stuff going on around it.
Yeah.
So I committed to building a strong general dentistry base.
Okay. And did you want to talk about like getting into advanced dentistry or adding services to your practice?
Yeah. So, also around this time was I started looking at, and I think this is the first time specialists felt recession too, from a double-edged recession. They felt a recession from the recession, but then they felt a recession from general dentists starting to keep more in-house.
Right, I was going to say you didn't want to refer out
as much. No, I mean, I need to do everything.
I don't like blood, but I'm going to take it out today.
So that's kind of when I first started taking out teeth. Because before that, I didn't take out teeth.
Mm-hmm.
I had already started doing some root canals, but I was limited to anteriors and premolars. And then I just said, I just try a molar.
Yeah.
I'll just start doing it. And that's kind of when I started really becoming a one-stop shop. I hate that word, but that's kind of what it is, right?
Yeah.
You know, a one-stop
but
shop.
But that's what people want to go to, right? I mean, we've talked about this so many times. Mm-hmm. Remember when you told me I needed to go to the periodontist to do crown length? I'm like, but I don't want to.
Yeah. Can you do it?
Yeah.
I'm like, you don't want me to do it.
But going to a new office, you know, we joke about this, but we say people don't want to go to a new parking lot.
They don't.
Like new front office, new parking lot, new people. It's not just a new doctor. It's a whole new scene for them. So they love a one-stop shop.
Yeah. And I'm glad that you brought that up, Meredith, because building a strong general dentistry base isn't just about building a hygiene pool and fillings and crowns and a restorative practice. It, to me, a strong general dentistry base is extractions, it's endodontics, it's some minor orthodontics and things like that. It's a broad range of services, so you minimize how much you start sending out of your practice.
Right.
You know, and that involves learning skills and sometimes you learn from YouTube, sometimes you learn from other specialists, sometimes you learn from other colleagues, sometimes you learn from other seminars, which is workshops, which is obviously what we do here at 3D Dentist. So I had to double down on building a good general practice.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about kind of how you executed that and some of the things you did to kind of reinvent the practice.
Yeah, you know, I kind of broke it down into, so let's talk about kind of looking back. And I can only do this because I'm looking backwards at what happened. And I kind of looked at everything in three buckets, Okay. Bucket number one was my personal self skills. Okay. My, mm-hmm. what I call soft skills, my bedside manner, my leadership skills, you know, my ability to talk and communicate and the words I use with patients and, you know, things like not talking too much about the recession, not having CNN or the news playing yeah. on the TVs in the practice, right. little things like that. The second bucket I looked at was my clinical skill set, because what the recession kind of proved to me was that my clinical skill set was limited mm-hmm. and limiting. Yeah. And that was important. And the third thing I looked at was what we call infrastructure here at 3D Dentists. And that's really the use and availability of technology to help reduce barriers. And so since I already had some technology, I had CAD-CAM, I had digital CAD-CAM was digital impression at the time, you know, one of the things I felt that I could do more of in my practice was dental implants. And I didn't feel the comfort and confidence to do implants without technology. So I said, you know what, I need to learn dental implants. So there's the clinical skills I need to learn. I wasn't so worried about the soft skills because, you know, I was selling cosmetic dentistry, $10,000, $12,000, right. $15,000 cases. So how hard could it be to sell a $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 single unit implant? So I wasn't so worried about the soft skills. And, you know, some of the words and the confidence came from the education. But then the execution of yeah. those implants became a problem. And that's when I decided to double down on CBCT. Mm-hmm. And so in 2009, I got a bank to loan me money to go buy a cone beam, a 3D x-ray, and really that kind of started the upward trend of coming back from this. And maybe the economy was kind of starting to pick back up a little bit at that time, but really for me the acceleration was, hey, now I have a technology or a tool that can help me do some dentistry for patients that don't want to go somewhere else.
Yeah.
And so to me, I've always looked at
technology.
And diagnose, absolutely. But I wasn't so worried about diagnosis yeah. at that
yeah,
point.
Yeah, but sometimes you would be able to see a root canal. You would
yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, those were the side effects. Right. What I call side effects of cone beam was seeing a tooth that had an infection on it, seeing a tooth that I thought needed endo, but it was blown out yeah. and endo was no point. You know, and that's where I first started realizing that technology wasn't about saving money, but technology was really about helping you make right. money. And so that's kind of what I mean. To me, technology should be used to break down barriers for your patient and barriers for yourself in terms of your confidence and skill set. So to me, that's how I view technology.
Okay, and what about your number one, your number one secret to your office,
yeah.
lastly?
Yeah, so, you know, for me, I double down on photography, yeah. you know, because, you know, whether we're in a recession or not, and more so when we're in a recession or there's a fear of a recession, I think people want proof. People want proof of what's going on. You know, the analogy I always use, it's like when you used to go to get your oil change and the guy brought out the air filter that was dirty. I know you've never taken your car for an oil change, Meredith.
I was looking at you like, yeah.
But they take you out. Caroline, have you gone where they've done that to you? They bring out this dirty air filter and you're like, of course I don't want this dirty air filter. And so then they sell you a dirty air, you know, they sell you a new air filter uh-huh. to replace the dirty air filter. And I look at dentistry that way. You know, yeah, do I really need this crown done? The tooth doesn't hurt me. But here's where you have some cavity. Here's where you have a big pothole in this old filling. Right. And so it allowed me to give them the proof so that they didn't feel that I was selling them. And honestly, I had more confidence because I didn't feel like I was selling them.
Right.
So I doubled down on photography. And this is kind of when the internet was kind of starting with Facebook and all of, not yeah. Instagram or any of these yeah. other things. It was really Facebook. And so this is where I was starting able to start building my personal brand by sharing these photos with the consumer community to help bring my build my personal brand to start attracting patients that were looking for that type of dentistry. So,
well,
yeah.
Hopefully this helps doctors in case we have a recession.
Yeah, you know, a couple other things I would point out to people mm-hmm. Because I want to give you some other pointers here. One is one of the things I learned from COVID, okay, yeah. and other recessions as well, but more so for COVID is when we see impending things coming or starting yeah. to happen, shrink your menu. Yeah. Get rid of non-profitable procedures, okay? So for me, dentures were a non-profitable procedure, so we got rid of dentures.
Right.
You know, for me, fillings are a low profitability procedure, so we limited the number of fillings that we could do. You know, for me, I stopped giving patients a choice to do lab fabricated posterior crowns. Hey, listen, I know you're willing to pay, but I don't want you to come back. I want to get it done in a single visit.
Yeah, I don't know that anyone's ever asked for that.
You know, and so like when people ask for gold crowns, I say we don't do them anymore because it's not worth the hassle of changing our routine for something that I'm literally going to make no extra money on.
Right.
And it's not that it's all driven by money, but then they run a business.
It's time.
You know, and it's the time. Time is money. Yeah. So I would shrink my menu of services. You know, for us, during some of the recessions, we got rid of whitening. Mm-hmm. Because whitening was labor intensive and low profitability, dentures, you know, things like that. Things that you may not do much of. Like, for example, let's say you do soft tissue grafting once every few months. I'd get it off the menu.
Yeah.
You know, until things get better and you can start, you know, developing that
especially
service.
Especially a time like now where you're limited on team members.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not worth having an extra team member to be able to offer whitening for $300.
When it costs you $150, $200 to do it to begin with.
Right.
Yeah, plus the time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, absolutely. So that's kind of how I look at it. You know, look, pay attention. Don't believe that a recession isn't coming. Don't believe that a recession is coming. Always be working on your business to kind of refine it and fine tune it. So that way, if the recession comes, if it's worse than we expect, if it's less worse than we expect, you know, you're not caught flat-footed like so many of us were caught flat-footed for COVID, because as a world, we weren't ready for this, other than China. But as a world, we weren't ready for this. So if you could leave us a review for 3D Dentists on Google, if you could leave us a review for the Dentistry Made Simple podcast on Apple Podcasts, and if we can help you at 3D Dentists, if you're looking for an amazing CE experience where you get to hang out with instructors that want to hang out with you and connect with you and hang out with other like-minded individuals and really learn dentistry from both a clinical side and a business implementation side, I don't believe anybody does it better than us. And I still take education from other places because I want to see what's out there. And I really believe that we have an amazingly unique product and experience that will help you grow, help your practice grow, and help everything in your life grow. So reach out to Meredith through social media or meredith@3d-dentists.com or visit us at www.3d-dentists.com. See you guys next week.